Hello students, welcome to today's class on functions. This is the last unit from your BBSUC subject. You know, we have discussed about many fundamental concepts related to C programming language, and this is the last topic BBSUC. So let us begin with the introduction to functions, why we need it, what we are going to learn in this unit. This is the syllabus prescribed for your BBSUC 5th unit. There are a few topics over here: designing structured programs, then functions in C, then how to define user-defined functions. Then we'll see how communication occurs between inter-function communication using the inter-function communication. Topic is standard functions or library functions. Then we discuss about a few advanced topics related to functions, that are passing arrays to functions and passing pointers to functions. And finally, we discuss about a special category of functions called as recursive functions. Okay, so this is your syllabus. So let us begin with what is a structured programming. Structured programming is a programming technique which a large program will be divided into smaller subprograms, such that the program, the large program, becomes readable, understandable, and it will be easy for us to implement the program. And also, the program makes use of code being submitted. Okay, so these many advantages are there with structured programming. And structured programming enables mainly code reusability. So the most important factor of structured programming is code reusability, which is a method of writing the block of code once and using it any number of times. So write once, use it any number of times will be the essential property of structured programming. And, structured programming also makes the program easy to understand because it is properly divided into blocks which are easily understandable by the users. Okay. So this means that the quality of program will be improved, and also when the program is given to others, it will be easy to understand and extend the corresponding program for the purpose of their own usage. Okay. So code reusability is the main factor that gives number of benefits. And how this structured programming is actually implemented, you see, it is implemented with the help of functions. So we make use of these functions to divide a larger program into smaller subprograms, and these subprograms are implemented individually. That means it will have the own definition in the program. So every subprogram is also called as a function in C. It's executed individually, but you need to call all those functions in order to execute them. Defining the function does not mean that you can execute it directly. For execution of the function, you need to call the body of another function. Okay, so this is about structured programming. We can design structured programs in C with the help of functions. Let us start with the introduction to functions now. A function is a self-contained block of statements which are used to achieve a particular task. Okay, so you need to remember that word self-contained block of statements. So simply, it's a group of statements which are used for solving a particular problem. Okay. The main purpose of using functions is to reduce the redundancy of code in a program. What is meant by redundancy? Redundancy means writing duplicate codes. So, writing duplicate codes can be avoided with the help of functions. What we do with functions is we write that duplicate code only once as a function, and we will call that function any number of times in your program execution whenever it is required without rewriting the corresponding code. So, that is the advantage we are going to get with the function, and we will reduce the redundancy of the code. Simply remember that redundancy means code duplication that can be minimized with functions. There are several benefits of using these functions. Let us see what are the major benefits that we are going to get with functions. The first benefit is C functions are used to provide rewriting same code again and again. This is what we always mention with respect to the functions. So you don't need to write the code again and again. Just write once and use it any number of times without rewriting it. And the second advantage is we can call functions any number of times. Once it is defined, you can call it any number of times in the program and from any place in the program. So that is the biggest advantage, which actually implements the structure of programming. And the third advantage is since we are writing functions which are reusable, a large program can easily be tracked and when it is divided into functions. That means if something goes wrong in your program, if the program is properly defined with functions, we can easily identify code blocks where the actual elements functions. The last advantage with functions is the core concept of functions are reusability, dividing a big task into small pieces to achieve the functionality and to improve understandability of very large programs. So you can see, these three points are always mentioned with respect to the benefits of functions. One is reusability. The second one is big program is divided into small programs, set of small programs. And there is always readability improved if functions are properly defined in your C program. Okay. So remember these three characteristics and the benefits that comes with the functions. Let us start with the concept of functions now. Coming to the classification, there are two types of functions that can be used in a C language. One is library functions, which we have already gone through it. We are already using a set of library functions still. And the second category of functions is user-defined functions. So this is what we are going to learn this chapter. Okay. Let us start with the first category, library function. Library functions are the functions which are already defined by the vendors of C language. They come with the definition of your header files. That means when you include a header file into your program, all the library functions stored in that header file will be available for use in your C program. So this we are already doing. So let us understand this with an example. If you include stdio.h into your C program, then you'll be able to utilize printf and scanf library functions in your program. So without using this stdio.h, you cannot make use of printf and scanf. These two functions, printf and scanf, are already predefined by the vendors. Therefore, they are called as library functions. Okay, so whatever function which is already defined by the vendors and are available for usage in your program, they are called as library functions. And other examples of library functions that we are regularly using is CLRSCR, which is meant for clearing your output screen, and GetCH to hold the output screen, or the library functions. These two are also library functions available in the header file for neighbor items. That is why we include this header file to make use of these two functions. Okay, so library functions are available, ready for usage in your program. You don't need to declare it, you don't need to define it because the definition is already there in the header files. Okay, so library functions are ready-made functions which can be used in your C programs. The second category of functions, user-defined functions, are the functions which will be developed by the programmers. Okay. Based on the problem that we are solving, we may require a set of user-defined functions to be created by us. Therefore, you need to know what are the steps or what are the essential things that you need to do for creating a user-defined function and then for using the user-defined function as part of your program. So you need to understand this process of creating and using these user-defined functions. Let us start with the basic things that are required for creating user-defined functions. So whenever you want to create a user-defined function, these three things must present in your program. The first one is function declaration, which is also called as function prototyping. Okay. And the second one is function definition. And the third one is function calling. These three should present in your program in order to create and use a function properly in your C program. Okay, there is a small thing you need to remember about function declaration. It is not necessary to declare a function always. It is optional. Function declaration is going to be optional based on where you actually doing this step. So if function definition is done before the main function, then you don't require this. If function definition is written after main function, then you will definitely have to declare the function also. Okay, so we'll see it in later sections. When function declaration is compulsory and when it is optional, we'll see it later. Okay, so just remember these three things. You require three concepts over here, three major components for creating and using functions: declaration of function, definition of function, and calling the function. Let us understand one by one. The first one is function declaration. This is generally done before the main or inside the main. General syntax of creating a function declaration is you need to specify the return type, that means what will be the value type that will be returned from the function, and the name of the function without violating the variable naming rules, followed by a set of parentheses. Inside the parentheses, if there are parameters, then you need to specify the types of parameters. Okay, so I repeat, you need to specify the return type of the function, maybe integer, float, character, based on what value will be returned by the function, and name of the function, followed by a set of parentheses in which we specify the data types of parameters. Okay, this may be empty if there are no parameters for the function. Okay, so a return type can be any valid data type in C language. There are several valid data types in C language, like char, int, float, double, non double, and so on. It can be anything, including void also. Okay, if the function is not returning anything, then you need to specify it as void. Right. For example, look at this function. Factorial is the function name, maybe meant for calculating the factorial of a given integer. Therefore, the parameter type is integer. Okay, so we want to find out factorial of this number. So factorial of int, and the result is going to be a long integer. Therefore, return type is long int. Okay, so this is long int is return type. Factorial is name of the function. Int is type of the parameter. So this is the function declaration example. I hope you understand now. Long int is the return type. Factorial is the name of the function, and int is the data type of the parameter in which it is created, right? And the second component, which is essential for creating the function, is this is the crucial step. This is compulsory done. Function definition. Generally, function definition contains two parts. One is function header, and the other one is function body. Function header simply contains same prototype which is specified in our previous step. It should say what is the return type of the function, it should say what is the function name, it should say what are the data types of the parameters along with the variables, that is names of the parameters. If there are multiple parameters, then you need to separate them with commas. Okay, so this is about the function header. It contains these four things. And the function body contains the code, the actual code for solving the problem in our hand. Okay. Now let us understand this with a simple syntax. The general syntax is the return type, function name. It should not have any function name, should not have any spaces. It is long int here. And the data type followed by parameter name. And you can have any number of parameters like this. Comma, separated by comma, data type parameter name 2, so on, you can have any number of things. So this is called as function header. Okay, this is called as function header. This function header should be same as the function prototype. Okay. then a set of curly braces would be used to define the body of the function. Here we write the actual code to solve the corresponding task under this function name. Okay, so every function will be meant for solving a particular subproblem. So to solve that subproblem, what is the code required? We need to mention it here. Okay, so these two parts, function header and body of the function together, forms the function definition. This entire thing is called as function definition, where function definition contains two things, function header and function body. Now let us understand this with an example. We continue the same example which we considered in function declaration. Long int factorial of int n. So here you can observe that we are mentioning the variable name also. If you look at the prototype or function declaration, you don't need to specify the variable name here. Just type is sufficient. Okay, and remaining things are same as a function definition, except that we are not mentioning the variable name. In function definition, you need to mention the variable name also. So long int factorial of int n. Inside that, you are writing the code. This is the actual code for calculating the factorial. And finally, you are returning the result fact. So this fact should be the same type which is mentioned over here, long int. Okay. So here we mentioned that fact as long int, so it is matching. It should match the return value from the function and the return type you mentioned in function header should match. Otherwise, there will be errors in your program. So this is about function definition. Once the function definition is ready, then you can call that function any number of times in your program. That means you can use that function to calculate the factorial of a given number in our example. So the general syntax of calling a function may fall into two types. If the function is returning a value, then you require a variable to catch that return value. So the first syntax will be variable name is equals to function name of parameters. Okay, so these are called as the values. You send the values to the function, it will calculate the result and it throws the result back to this variable, where this variable name stores the value returned by the function. Or if the function is not returning any value, then just call the function without any variable to assign the result, because there is no result returned by the function. It is sufficient to call the function with its name and sending the parameters in. Okay, so either this way or this way you can call the function. So when to use these two syntaxes? This syntax will be used when you have the function returning some value. Therefore, you need a variable to catch that return value. Okay, otherwise, if the function is not returning any value, then you can simply call the function like this. For example, I'm calling the function factorial of n here, and I'm storing the result into fact is equals to factorial of n. Suppose if I send 5 here in place of n, factorial of 5 will result 120, which will be stored in fact. Okay, so the fact stores the results sent by this factorial of n. Right. So the after understanding these three major components required for creating the functions, now let us go through few essential things that you need to remember while creating functions. The first thing you need to remember is, what is a calling function? Okay, and also you need to understand what is a called function. Let us say I have defined two functions, f1 and f2. In f1, I'm calling function f2. Okay, so since f1 is calling f2, f1 is called as calling function. That means if a function calls another function, it is treated as a calling function. Okay, and a function which is called by other function, it is called as a called function. So in this example, because f1 is calling f2, f1 will be treated as calling function and f2 will be treated as called function. So remember this terminology. When we discuss about several types of functions later on. You need to understand this properly, what is a calling function and what is a called function. The first terminology you need to understand. Okay. Then next point that you need to remember is, what are actual parameters and what are formal parameters? Okay. Suppose in this example, because you are sending values A and B to F2 as parameters, these two are called as actual parameters. That means the parameters that are sent in function calling, you are calling the function F2 here. So in function calling, if any parameter is used, it is said to be actual parameter. Okay. The parameters which are used in function calling are called as actual parameters. So A and B are actual parameters. And the parameters which are used in function definition, this is function definition of F2, and these are parameters. So F2 is using two variables here. These two variables are called as formal parameters because it is used in function definition. Therefore, X and Y are treated as formal parameters. So the definition goes like this. Parameters which are used in function definition are called as formal parameters. Okay. So function calling makes use of actual parameters. Function definition makes use of formal parameters. Next thing is, there are a few more things you need to remember. What is meant by function prototyping? This I already told you. Function prototyping is nothing but function declaration. Both are same. Function declaration or function prototype, both means declaring a function before its usage. Okay. The next point that you need to remember is when to use this function declaration and when function declaration is not compulsory. I told this earlier also. The function definition, if it is defined before main function, then declaration is not necessary. Okay, so I repeat, if the function is defined main function, then declaration is not necessary. Otherwise, you need to declare the function explicitly. It is compulsory then. Okay. And the next point, the most important point that you need to understand is, the function definition should not contain another function definition. Okay. So when you are defining a function, the body of the function should not contain another function definition. Okay. So that is not possible. It gives error messages, compiling error messages. Next and important point is, function calling should be always written inside the body of another function. That means you should call a function from the body of another function only. Sometimes you can call the function from the body of same function also, which is a special category of functions. We'll discuss about it later under the recursive functions head. Okay, so we'll discuss about that later. But generally, most of the times, function will be called from the body of another function. Right. And the next thing is, if a function declaration is placed inside the main function, read this properly. If a function declaration is placed inside the main function, okay, then the corresponding function is visible to main function only, and you can call the function from the main function only. Okay, other functions cannot use the corresponding function which is declared inside the main. If you want to allow the function to be called by main as well as other functions also, then you need to put that function declaration before main function only. Okay. So based on your requirement, if you want to call the function from the body of main function only, then it is sufficient to declare the function inside main function itself. If you want to allow other functions also to call this function, then declare that function before the main function or write the function definition before the main function. So both will allow you to call the corresponding function from either main function or from the body of other functions also. Okay. So remember these points while you are creating functions, user defined functions particularly in your C program. Now let us understand the concept of these functions with the help of some examples. The first example is, I want to find out square of a given number. identify the three parts which are essential for your C program, for your function creation and usage. What are the three things that are required? The first category is you need a function declaration. Okay, so this is function declaration. And this is function declaration or function prototyping. You need, because it is declared here, either main function can use it or other functions also can use it, but here it is only called by the main function. Okay, so this declaration may be present before main function or inside the main function also at this place. Okay, right. So because I want to find out square of a number, I name it as square. You can use any name here. And because I want to find out square of a given value, I am treating it as a float value, because float can store any real number and also integers. Okay, and the return type, after calculating the square of the given number, the result is also going to be float. Okay, if this is declared as int, then the result is also going to be int. Return type is also going to be int. So here I took it as the value type is float and the return type is also float. So this is called function declaration. And inside the main function, I'm asking the user to enter some number for finding square. So if user enters a value, I'm storing it into m. Because m is declared as float, I'm using scanf percentile f here, comma, ampersand m for storing the value. So once m is available, just pass this m to the function square. Square of m will call the function. This is called function calling. And immediately, when this is executed, square of m is executed, the control goes to control immediately transfers to here, the function definition. So whenever a function call is executed, the control will be transferred to the corresponding function definition. But actually what happens in program execution is, when you compile your program, the address of this function definition will be replaced at the place of function call. That is, square of m is replaced by the address of this function definition. Therefore, it is properly linked. So the linker job is replacing the address of function definition at the place of function call. Okay, so we already know the responsibility of the linker. So once it is done, by looking at the address over here, the control immediately transferred to the corresponding address where the function definition is present. Okay, so function definitions are also present in RAM. They have addresses, as I told you. That is how, in our previous lectures, we saw how to use pointers to point to functions also. And the linkers utilizes the corresponding address of the function definition and copies them at the place of function call. So with this address, it goes to the function definition by copying the value. M is, the value of M is now copied to X. Now M is copied to X, therefore the value in X is same as M. So what we are doing here, we are declaring a general variable P. P is equal to X into X, X square is calculated, and the result is P, and returning that result back to the corresponding function. So once this statement executes, return P, this P is again comes over here. That means in place of this square, the value which is returned from here, for example, if you say X is 3, P stores 9, 3 into 3, 9 will be returned from here. So this square of M is now 9, which is copied to N. So 9 will be stored into N now. Okay. So 9 will be copied to N. Like this. Now N contains the value returned by the function square of M. and then you can use the printf function to store to display the value to the user. Square of the given number is percentile f comma m comma m. M is replaced over here and n is replaced over here. Okay, so what is n? N is 9. What is m? M is 3. So if you send 3, it returns 9, which is copied to n. Okay, so this is how the function works. So whenever a function call is present in your program, while execution, the control will be transferred immediately to the function definition when it reaches the corresponding function call. Okay, that is the point you need to understand. And then once the function execution is completed, it comes back to the place of where the function is called, and then the program execution resumes from this point. Okay, so you need to understand how the control, the program execution control, is transferred from function call to function definition, and then how it is coming back to function call again after execution of function definition. Just remember that point. Okay, so if you understand these topics, then it will be easy for you to understand how a function executes. Okay, we'll go through one more example to more it make it more clear understanding. Let's go through another example. Here I am writing a function for addition of two given numbers. If you observe the difference, in this example, function is defined after main function. See, here it is main, and the function is defined after main function. Therefore, because you define the function after main, you need to declare the function before main or inside the main. Okay, so that is the reason why we declared the function over here. And if you look at this example, the function is defined directly before main function. Okay, so the definition exists before main function. Therefore, you don't need any function declaration here. So that is the reason why it is omitted from your program. Function declaration is not done here in this example. Okay, I hope you understood now why it is not written. Function declaration is not written here. Why it is not written? Because the function definition is already present before the main function itself. If you write like this, then you don't need to declare it explicitly. Okay, now I'm asking the user to enter first number and storing it into variable 1, enter number 2 and storing it into number 2, variable 2. And then if you understand the previous example, this is function calling and this is function definition. While comparison itself, linker substitutes the address of function definition at this place. Okay, by using this address, when the program executes and it comes over here with function calling, it goes to the function definition at the beginning of function definition by copying the variables in the same order. That means variable 1 is copied to number and variable 2 is copied to number. Okay, I hope you understand. Variable 1 is copied to number, variable 2 is copied to number. Okay, now the execution begins from the first statement of the function. We declared a temporary variable sum. Sum is equal to num1 plus num2. They are already available here, num1 plus num2. And return sum. When this statement executes, return sum is executed, the control comes back to the function calling again. So it comes back with the corresponding result sum. For example, if I send 10 comma 20 here, the result that is sent from this function definition will be 30. So it copies 30 over here. Okay, that 30 is now stored into RES. So now RES contains the result returned by the function addition of variable 1 comma variable 2, that is 30. And then you can display the result printf output percentile d comma res, that displays the output to the user as 30. Okay, so this is the second example. Now, can you identify what are the actual parameters over here? Can you identify the actual parameters? Where are they? Yes, variable 1 and variable 2. These two are actual parameters since they store values and they are sent through the function calling. So whatever variables we are using in function calling, these parameters are called as actual parameters, or there is another name for these, arguments. So either you can use the name actual parameters or you can use arguments also. Okay. And then what are formal parameters in this program? Can you identify the formal parameters? The formal parameters are, what are formal parameters? Yes, number 1 and number 2, these two. Num1 and num2 are the formal parameters in our example. Okay. Identify the formal parameters. It is num1 and num2. This is function definition. This is function header. And this is function body. And this is function calling. Since the function is defined before main, we don't have any function prototype here, right? So with this example, I hope you understood the concept of creating user-defined functions. We'll see more examples as practice exercises later. Okay. So I request all of you to write a function to perform the multiplication of given two numbers. Okay, so this is an example for creating addition of two numbers function. So similarly, by keeping it as a reference, all of you try to write a function for multiplication of given two numbers. Okay, this is an exercise for you. Please practice it to understand how functions can be created. So we'll go through more examples in the next session once we understand the some advanced topics related to functions in our next session. Then we will go through some important programs with respect to the functions. Okay, so that's all for today. Hope you understood the fundamentals of functions and how to create them in C programs. Thank you all for your patient listening. That's all for today. We'll continue the concept of functions with more advanced topics in our next session. Thank you all.